back to On the Sofa with me, Hayley. Now, I am joined by ex-CBBC presenter and sports commentator. It's only Michael Absalom.
Hi, here we are. I'm doing really well. What a great day we've got for it. And we're off the sofa.
We're off the sofa. Yeah. But I've got to say, we are living the dream right now.
Yeah, we are. It's a beautiful day. What I really love, we're on the banks of the Thames, and there's these mudlarks around that are looking for treasure. Just on the back of the
Thames.
Have you seen? Can you not? You scared of heights?
Yeah.
It's about this high. It's not far. Are you really scared of heights?
Yeah, I'm really scared.
What will happen if you look over
the
edge?
No, stop it. Anyway, back to you, Michael. How are you doing? I'm loving the new hair.
Thanks. Everyone thinks I look like Joe Wick, is it? He's the health guy.
Yes.
I don't look anything like him, but I've got a similar sort of hairstyle at the moment, so people keep double-taking me in the street.
Do they? Do they actually come up to you and like, are you Joe Wick?
No, they haven't said that yet, but I think I know that's what they're thinking, because they just sort of do this.
Then they're really disappointed.
They are. They're like, it is. It isn't.
Oh, well, anyway, it's Michael Absalom. Yeah. And I mean, I know you from way back, back in the CBBC presenter days.
Yeah.
How many years ago was that?
I've lost track. I started presenting on Children's BBC in 2002. So what's that, 17 years? Don't have enough fingers. 17 years since then. And you used to come along and watch Panto.
I did, love a bit of Panto.
I think you came to watch when I played Smee down in Poole, down at the Lighthouse Theatre there in Dorset. And you came along with a couple of your friends and came and cheered.
Oh yeah.
He's behind you. Oh no, he isn't. Yes, he
Nothing's
is.
Changed. Love a bit of Panto.
But you're doing well. This is nice.
Well, you know, I like to talk, Michael. So do you. So this is going to go well, hopefully.
I mean,
not well.
Yeah, I mean, people can always turn over. Don't turn over. We're trying not to bore you to death. But you're getting some great guests on the show.
Yeah, we are. Might get Joe Wicks next week.
Yeah, it'd probably be more entertaining than me, to be honest. Do you know what? It's amazing. I have a mutual friend that lives out near Richmond. And I had tea with her yesterday. It's very civilised, adult and grown up.
I was going to say, you've grown up.
Yeah, I know. Normally it's a couple of beers, a couple of shots, and now we go for afternoon tea. But she was saying that he's organised this thing around Richmond Park this weekend where he just sort of posts this note saying, right, I'm going to be in Richmond Park, 8 a.m. tomorrow morning, anyone turn up and we'll go for a walk around the park, which is 7 miles. And I thought that was amazing. I thought that's an amazing way to get everyone up and out. But anyway, I sound like I'm doing his PR for him.
Anyway,
no, I'm a big fan.
Yeah, we love that.
I might just sort of pretend to be him. I need to grow the beard a bit more and I need to work on the six pack.
Right, okay, well, maybe stay after the afternoon tea and, you know.
Stay off the scones.
Yeah, stay off the scones. Hard to do, I know. Yeah. So let's go back to back in the BBC presenter days. How was that for you? Because, I mean, it's a long time ago now, but it was a great platform for you, wasn't it?
It was. It's where I launched my career, I would say, in live television and the pressures that come with that. And, you know, we were on air 12 hours a day having to produce and turn over live content really fast. So it was like this factory of just content just flying off the shelves. And I was young as well. I was 22 when I started. So you got all this enthusiasm and, you know, I think I've still got that enthusiasm and hunger, but you're a little bit wiser and maybe a little bit more jaded as well and a bit more informed on how tough it is to get into TV, film, to be a musician, to be an artist. All these creative jobs, they're very tough to get into and also to sustain a career in them as well. I'm just in awe of all of us that are able to do that. I'd say most of my friends that I work with on CBBC are still going strong. The likes of Jake Humphrey on BT Sport, Holly Willoughby doing This Morning, Fern Cotton, Ade Adapatam, Matt Baker, you know, got all these amazing names of people that are doing a great job and people that are still there. So a good friend of mine, Barney Harwood, used to do Blue Peter. He only just left about 6 or 8 months ago. And
so I'm not going anywhere.
But I guess it's just, like you say, a great platform to launch your career, and we've got to do some weird and wonderful things and interact with kids as well, who I think, if you're a parent, you sort of already know this, but they allow you to have that excuse to be an eternal kid. And so you can go and build sandcastles on the beach, or you can go and chuck a custard pie in someone's face and just go, it's just my job.
Sorry about that. And how did you actually get your break into children's TV? Because that's pretty hard to do.
Yeah, well, that's a good question. It took me about 3 years actually to actually get my foot in the door at the BBC. And I just wrote loads of letters back in the day. So it was before email, it was before mobile phones. I know.
He's really old.
Dinosaur. Dinosaur. and I just, my dad was really helpful actually, and gave me a few useful tips, helped me draft a letter, which we sort of just copied and pasted. Oh. And we sealed 100 up and we sent them off to various people, and CBBC were one of the only people to get back to us. Wow. And say, let's give you some work experience. So I actually started as a runner, making cups of tea for people. And I must have made a good cup of tea, because then they sort of gave me the opportunity to go for screen tests, and I didn't get the job initially, but they kept calling me back and they saw that something was there. And before that, I used to do these sort of these modelling competitions as well. I never won, weirdly. A bit annoying. But you're, I don't know, at that age, you're screaming out for any opportunity to be seen. Yeah. And the news, actually, down where we used to live, down in the Portsmouth
area. South Coast Massive, aren't we?
South Coast Massive.
Yeah.
Is that still the symbol?
I don't know, but I'll take that. I think there might be X Factor, but never mind.
Just getting that. I'm dyslexic. I did a modelling competition, which I did actually win for the news. I did another one called The Face of 97, which, again, I met Fern Cotton at and was judged by Richard Branson and Kate Moss for store model management. Didn't win it. I then got onto The Face of 2000 on The Big Breakfast.
I remember that.
Yeah, and I was again strutting on the catwalk. Again, didn't get the job. Weirdly, 2 years beforehand, Tom Hardy launched sort of his career there before going off to acting school and becoming the Tom Hardy that we know now as well. So what I love is there's all these sort of weird interactions in my own career where you compare the likes of where everyone else has been in their career as well, and you go, yeah, life is pretty good.
So you didn't win the modelling competitions, but
thanks for rubbing that
You are on the Colgate advert.
Yes, I did.
Smile. Yeah.
Colgate smile. You've got a good smile too, though, as well, haven't you?
It's called getting through the day, Michael. It's a long day for me.
You've been bouncing up and down, and you're like, you've got your own broomstick, and you whiz here, there, and everywhere.
I know. I only stop when I get to Nando's later.
Oh, come and join you. I'll come and enjoy extra spicy. Colgate was great. Colgate was again another good opportunity, but a different field. Again, I've tried to add all these different strings onto my bow over the years, so I don't specialise in anything, I would say. I just have a go at everything and try and just give it my best shot and try and live my fullest life. It's sort of quite earthy, new age.
So how did the Colgate advert come about? Do they just go, you, smile?
No, they don't. It's a really tedious process. So you end up in a room with 100 people that look like you, sound like you, have a smile just like you. And so that's quite a weird experience. And again, you just get selected by someone and narrowed down and to maybe, you know, 15-20, and then you have to do the lines for the advert, which I think it's about a floss test and making sure that you don't have bleeding gums.
And do you have any fillings?
I have so many fillings. I've got about 20 fillings, but I used to love sweets as a kid. I still do now, sort of Haribo and just anything gummy. I just live on those. I'm like a sugar monster, a sugar hound. And it's so good. And then I get hyperactive. Keep me away from coffee. Keep me away from tequila. And I'm all right. But, yeah, so, I mean, ironically, yeah, you end up doing an advert like the Colgate advert. But it's just, again, a process where you have to go through this process of elimination. You're whittled down. And eventually you're chosen for the job. I think my presenting skills came in quite handy there, because I was playing a moderator who was advising people on how to have better gum health and take care of their teeth. So I was just being a driving force behind Colgate, Total Pro Gum Health.
Love it. Well, I still haven't got over my wisdom teeth having to be taken off. That's the worst thing ever.
What's your experience? What happened?
I won't even go there, but the worst day of my life, Michael.
I don't sound very manly here. I was in bed for 2 weeks afterwards. I couldn't, my face swelled up, and obviously working in front of a camera, you know, you don't want to go chubby bunny. Have you ever done that? You take marshmallows and you shove them in your mouth.
I have seen clips of you doing this, Michael.
I do it with fudge as well, actually. Chubby bunnies, it's a really good game. You have to say, you have to put a marshmallow in and then say chubby bunnies. Then you would put one in and have to say it. Then I would put two in. And it's a game you could maybe bring to the sofa.
I feel like this could
what
be good.
Do it next week with some poor guest that doesn't know it's coming. Have a game of chubby bunnies.
Well, you heard it here first. We'll make this happen.
It's really funny. And it's the the loser is the first person who can't say chubby bunnies.
Right, okay.
And the winner is the person. And yeah, it's quite amazing.
Into your talents, is there? I mean, we've had it all.
Yeah. Well, that's it. Well, it's all about adapting and growing and evolving. Yeah. And that's sort of what I've done through my career. And as I said, it's been about 17 or 18 years now that I've been going.
Yeah.
And a variety of things from presenting to TV commercials to acting, which is sort of the next thing that I'm trying to do. And again, it's re-educating yourself, it's learning all the tricks of the trade, it's applying yourself, it's about having the right mentality, working hard, as you know, to get the results and just grinding it out till you create an opportunity for yourself.
Yeah, I mean, I think what you said there about mentality, I mean, for me, everything is a mindset.
Yeah.
And I think in this business, you know, people just don't realize how important that is.
It's tough, and in the show that I'm going to be doing later this month, it's about educating the audience about that. I think something like 90% of actors are out of work at any given time.
Yeah.
And so you think about the number of people, and they're all good. All these people
can
act.
Yeah.
All these people can either sing, they can play an instrument. That they are a talented bunch of creatives, yet they aren't given that platform to showcase their talents. We see it every week on The X Factor, or you see it every week on Britain's Got Talent, just the amount of talent that's out there. And so I think there's an element of good luck that comes with each individual's story. But again, I also think you've got to create your own luck. You've got to put yourself out there. You've got to take a few risks.
We'll catch you after the break, where we'll be talking more to Michael Absalom.